Welcome to Re'eh Yisrael, which means in English, Behold, O Israel, the Bible-teaching television ministry of Congregation Shema Yisrael. Shema Yisrael is a Messianic Jewish congregation in Rochester, New York. Be sure to get out your Bible and a notebook and follow along with this week's lesson from the Scriptures. Shalom. Thank you for watching this video. I'm taking a moment to share some important information about Congregation Shema Yisrael. We are following the leading of the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, to purchase a new facility for our congregation in the heart of the Jewish community of Rochester, New York. We've experienced several miraculous confirmations that this purchase is God's plan to make us more effective in our outreach to the Jewish community here. Our previous facility has been sold, and we are meeting in rented quarters until we close on the new facility at the end of 2020. Through the generous donations of our regular attenders, we've raised a significant part of the funds that will be needed to close, but we also need your help. If you've been blessed by our videos, please pray for us and ask the Lord, what do you want to do through me to accomplish your will for Congregation Shema Yisrael? If you pray this prayer and do what God leads you to do in faith, we will succeed in purchasing this facility and become much more effective in reaching the Jewish people of Rochester with the life-saving good news of Messiah Yeshua. To participate, please visit shematime.org, that's shematime.org, where you can learn more about this amazing move of God and where you can support us by clicking the donate button. Thank you, and may the Lord richly bless you as you watch this video.
Adonai Echad, Baruch Shem, Kevod Malchuto, Leolam Vaed. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Blessed be his name, whose glorious kingdom is forever and ever. Ve'ahavta et Adonai Elohecha b'chol levavcha u'v'chol nafshecha u'v'chol me'odecha. V'hayu hadvarim ha'ele asher anochi mitzavcha hayom al levavecha v'shinan tam levenecha b'dibarta bam, b'shiftecha, b'vitecha, uv'lechtecha, v'adelech, uv'shachpecha, uv'kumecha, uk'shatam l'ot al yedecha, v'hayu l'totafot bein einecha, uk'tavtam al mezuzot beitecha, uv'yisharecha. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. And these words which I command you this day shall be upon your heart, and you shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall speak of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. And you shall bind them for a sign upon your hand, and they shall be for frontlets between your eyes. And you shall write them upon the doorposts of your house and upon your gates. Ve'ahavta l'areacha kamocha, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Amen. We can also thank our Father for sending Yeshua to be our Messiah. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher natan lanu et derech ha-Yeshua b'mashiach Yeshua, Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us the way of salvation in Messiah Yeshua. Amen. And we can thank God for the seventh day of rest.
V'shamru v'nei
Yisrael et ha-Shabbat la'asot et ha-Shabbat le'dorotam barit olam. B'nei uvein, b'nei Yisrael, oti le'olam, oti le'olam. V'shamru b'nei Yisrael et ha-Shabbat la'asot et ha-Shabbat v'dorotam barit olam. Ki sheshet yamim asa Adonai et ha-Shamayim v'et ha-Aretz. V'shamru b'nei Yisrael et ha-Shabbat la'asot et ha-Shabbat v'dorotam barit olam. Uv'ayom ha-Shvi Shabbat v'inefash, Shabbat v'inefash, Shabbat v'inefash. V'shamru b'nei Yisrael et ha-Shabbat la'asot et ha-Shabbat le'dorotam barit olam. The children of Israel shall keep the Shabbat throughout their generations as an everlasting covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. Amen. All right, worship team can come on up. And we're going to continue with the Adonai Sefatai. Adonai Sefatai Tiftachu Fia Gita Hilatecha. Adonai Sefatai Tiftachu Fia Gita Hilatecha. Adonai, open up my lips, that my mouth may declare your praise. Amen.
Shabbat shalom. Not sure I heard that. Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God, that we are free in Messiah. We praise you and we thank you, Lord God. We want to worship you with all our hearts. Hallelujah.
Let the fire of the Holy One burn.
one burn up that virus in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach. Woo! Yeah! Burn it up, Lord. Burn it up. Burn it up. Burn it up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And remember, folks, God is right here. Get yourself up on a high mountain, O Zion, bearer of good news, and lift up your voices mightily, Jerusalem, bearer of good news. Lift them up, do not fear. Lift them up, do not fear. And say to the cities of Judah, your God is here. The righteousness of the Lord, your God is here.
Right here.
The majesty of the Lord, your God is here. About you guys, but it has been quite the week. Amen? But you know what? Do not fear, because God really is right here. He's never left our side, not for 1 minute. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you are always with us. Always. Even when we don't feel like it, you are always with us. Because, Lord God, there is none like you. Hallelujah. One who calms the raging storm, the one who walks upon the sea. Earth and heaven are your own, yet you're watching over me. thank you, Lord, that we can have joy and we can rejoice in spite of all the chaos that's going on around us, because we have got the joy in our heart and the sun is shining in our heart. The S-O-N. Lord, we thank you for your Ruach HaKodesh, your Holy Spirit. Oh, Lord, fill us more with your Holy Spirit. Ruach, blow through this place. Blow through this place even now, right now. Hallelujah. your people, burning desire, Lord, on your people, pour out your fire, Lord, on your people, let it rain.
Continue to cry out, Lord, pour out your mercy, not just on us, Lord, but the whole world right now. We know we deserve your judgment, not only us, but the whole world. And we cry out for mercy, oh Lord, mercy. Pour out your grace and your mercy, Father, on all those who are sick right now, who are suffering, all those, Lord, who have lost loved ones. Pour out your mercy, Father, your chesed, your loving kindness. Thank you, Lord, that you are full of that. There is no limit to it. And we pray for your mercy right now, Father. We thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you for allowing us to gather today, Father. And we just are so thankful that we're in a place. Next week, we may not be able to be here even. So we thank you, Lord, for today. We treasure today. We treasure today where we can gather together. And we just thank you for your presence here, Father. Thank you that you have poured out your spirit, not just your mercy, but your spirit, and that we're all experiencing the presence of your spirit in us and around us. In Yeshua's name, thank you. And let's give a little hand thanks to the worship team. Thank you, worship team. So I'm going to repeat some of the announcements I made earlier because a lot of you weren't here. First of all, we are in compliance with the governor who set some guidelines for groups meeting. We are well below the number of 500, which he said was the was the upper limit. And we're okay, but we are doing a couple of different things. We sanitized the seats this morning with Lysol, and we, if you didn't notice it, we didn't do any hand clasping during dances. And when we get to the point, we're just going to, in a couple of minutes, where we're going to take a break and let everybody greet each other. We've had a couple of suggestions on what that greeting should be. It should not be hugs. It should not be handshakes. Okay? It should not be elbow bumps. You know why? Because people sneeze into their elbows and cough into their elbows. So we are suggesting the Middle Eastern style, which is bows. And if you are a Victorian lady, then if a gentleman bows towards you, you can curtsy. I don't even know. How do you do that? Like this? Or if you're athletic, you can do the toe bump. If you're not going to fall over when you put your... So thank you for all of you for coming. And if you are a guest here for the first time, we have a guest package for you. So if we missed you when you came in, you can still get this guest package. Raise your hand, and Don will give you one. If you have one of those, bring it to Don at the end of the service. And there is a booklet in there that describes where we're going, because this is our temporary home, and we are going to be moving. And let me just ask for a moment here. Randy, could you change seats? You are right in the line of the camera over there. Let's see. That should do it, right? So just if anybody's nervous about being online, we are live streaming because obviously there's a lot of people who usually come here and are not here today. But the camera is over there right in front of the soundboard, and it's only showing the speaker platform. So if you're back there, you're not going to be, don't worry, you're not going to be online unless you walk over there and walk between the camera and what it's focused on. Then you will be. Then you, with this? No, she's talking about online. So, yeah, we have sound here. Maybe turn it up a little bit. Okay. Okay, so... also, I want to make a cancellation announcement. The Messianic Judaism class, which a bunch of you attend, is canceled for this week. Not because of the virus or anything, but I have to attend a conference, a phone conference, on Tuesday. Those of you in Judaism class, and it sounds like I'm losing it here, come the next week. Okay. And that's in the lower Blossom Room over in that corner out that door.
So today on Bagels and Blessings from 2 to 3 p.m. on 990 a.m. or 107.1 FM or online at WDCXAM.com. Ethel will be having lovely music today. If you are trying to learn some of the Messianic music or you want to know some of the newer stuff, then definitely check out Ethel's show because she plays all the new stuff, all the great artists, so check that out. Tomorrow we will still be having the memorial service for Ron Alexander. That will be here at 4 o'clock. There will be a small kiddush afterwards, and his family is coming. So we did manage to get a hold of his family, so that's great. They are coming. Teshuva prayer will be Thursday at 6:30 in the Lower Blossom Room. So please join us as we pray for our nation and the world, which greatly needs it right now. Ava is not here, but you can see her for more information on that. And I forgot to put on my sheet, but it's in your bulletin, that Wednesday is the Shabbat school team, I think it's the B team? Judith, is it the B team? B team meeting, so please see Judith on that one if you need more information. Friday is our Erev Shabbat group. That is 6:30 p.m. at Naoka's house. This is where we bring in the Shabbat and discuss the Parsha readings for the week. So as Naoka said, please come. And our youth group will be meeting from... So Naoka's commanding you to come. The youth group will meet at 7 p.m. Are you guys going to be in the youth room or are you going out? Okay, be in the youth room. That's for ages 12 to 18, and see Yami for more information on that. We do have a kiddush planned for after service next week, but that is to be determined to see, how things, you know, things are pretty up in the air right now. But as far as we know, that is still going on. So that's after service next week. The Chi'ish Echad, or the As One Man group, is meeting Sunday, March 22nd at 10:30 a.m. In theory at William Ferris's house, but we'll see if that ends up getting moved back to Mark's. And then the Benafshi class, which is Thursday, March 26th at 7:30 in the Lower Blossom Room. This is actually very applicable right now because this teaches you how to deal with a lot of the spiritual things that are going on, the in-depth understanding of spiritual roots of disease and difficulties, and especially right now as our nation is gripped with an unprecedented level of fear. This is a great class to come and learn how to deal with that, how to remove it from your life, and how to remove the roots of things that cause disease and difficulties and things. So it's a great class. You do not have to have come before. Rabbi Jim is more than happy to catch you up. So if you have any questions, please see him. Beginner's dance class is Saturday, March 28th at 10:30. Again, kind of we're seeing on that one. See Shea for more info on that one. Okay, we want to see some men at that class. So there you all go. You've been told. So Rabbi Jim gets lonely up there. So our leadership meeting is Sunday, March 29th at 11 a.m. in the Scottsville office. This is mandatory for all of our leaders. And unfortunately, the Night to Honor Israel has been canceled. CUFI has canceled all of their events for the next couple months. So that is very sad. So we're all sad for that. So, yep. Also, if you happen to be out and about and find some place that is not emptied by hoarders, Okay, so we've never really worried about hand sanitizer around here because Naoka always kept us filled up, and plus, yeah, we're just not that germ, you know, conscious. But anyways, so now we caught the wave of we should get the hand sanitizer a little too late. So if anybody's out and about and happens to see hand sanitizer, which I know is like gold right now, it would be wonderful if we could get a few things. And see me after service for any information on that. And so now I hand it over to Rabbi Jim.
It's time to receive our tithes and offerings. So if you need an envelope for your giving, raise your hand and Don or someone will get you one. You don't need an envelope if you're giving by check to get a tax receipt. You'll still get one. And let me just remind you also, if you haven't filled out the contact information form, I believe that we have them on the table over there. This is very important, as we found out with Ron Alexander, because we had no way to contact his family because we had no idea how to get hold of his family. So these new contact information forms actually have a line on there asking for you to give us like somebody next of kin so that if something happened to you, we could find out something about it. So in 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and verse 7, Rabbi Shaul wrote this, but just as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in your love for us, see that you also excel in this grace of giving. So these things that he listed there, faith, speech, knowledge, earnestness of love, they're all important. And what Rabbi Shaul is saying here is that giving ranks up there with all of these. In fact, if you go into the concordance and you do a little study, this is amazing. Believe, the word believe is used 309 times. The word pray is used a little more, 375 times. The word love is used 800 times. But the word give, it's used 1,640 times. Isn't that amazing? And as I prayed about this, I think it's simply because God is a giver. He's given us everything, and he wants us to become like him. So let's pray. Thank you for being a giver, Lord. You are the universe's greatest giver. You gave it life. You gave it creation. You give us your love. You give us salvation. You give us, as your word says, all that we need to give to every good work, all that we need to establish your covenant. And we just thank you for that today. And we give unto you, Lord, because you're a giver and we want to be like you. So we ask that you bless this offering and the tithes and multiply them, and that you would continue to provide to establish and grow your kingdom in Yeshua's name. Amen.
All right, we're going to continue worshiping the Lord as we get our offerings and tithes ready. And so if you want to stand up, you can. If you don't want to, but that's fine. But at least clap your hands and let's praise Him. The blind men see and the lame men walk in Yeshua's name. The dead are raised and sorrow turns to praise in Yeshua's name. Yeshua, Yeshua, Messiah. From their sins, hallelujah, to save His people from their sins. Demons flee and captives are set free in Yeshua's name. Mercy's found and the grace of God abounds in Yeshua's name. Yeshua, Yeshua, Messiah, He has come to live and die and rise again. From their sins, hallelujah, to save His people from their sins. There'll come a day when every knee shall bow to Yeshua's name. So call upon the God of Jacob now in Yeshua's name.
Everybody,
Yeshua, Yeshua.
We have any children, do we? Okay, we're going to dismiss the children then. So we need four gentlemen to bring the tallit out.
Which, of course, doesn't mean that she has to be dismissed, just that we want to bless her anyway. And her name's already in the blessing. Yisimcha Elohim k'Ephraim v'chimeneshe, yivisimech Elohim k'Sarah Rivka Rachel v'Leah. Lord, make our sons like Ephraim and Manasseh, forgetting the troubles of their past and having a fruitful future. Lord, make our daughters like Sarah and Rebekah, like Rachel and like Leah, who built the house of Israel. Lord, I pray that you would bless little Leah, that you would fill her with strength and valor, that you would make her a warrior in your kingdom, that you would give her good health all her days and joy all her days, that she would be filled with your spirit, that you would make her life just overflow with your spirit in everything she does and says, Lord, and that you'd protect her from all harm. In Yeshua's name, amen.
So we're going to come before the Lord in prayer, which I think is very, very important today. And let me make a couple of announcements about this first. Everybody is invited to participate in the pre-service prayer meeting at 10:30 in the Lower Blossom Room over there every Shabbat, every Saturday morning. The other announcement is, don't know whether you've seen it or not, but President Trump declared tomorrow a National Day of Prayer for the nation. So we are having a memorial service for Ron at 4 o'clock, so I just thought we could gather here at 3 if you want to pray together for the National Day of Prayer. So we'll just be gathered here and praying for the National Day of Prayer. So I hope you can make it for that. So let's just come before the Lord in some prayer. And I know it's all on everybody's heart, Father, that we would ask you that you would stop the spread of the coronavirus. We ask for wisdom for our government leaders in protecting us and the government leaders in all the nations of the world to protect people from the virus. We ask for healing for those who have it right now. And we ask for comfort for those who have lost loved ones already. And we just commit that to you, Father. And there's a couple of things here that I believe the Holy Spirit has given me to share and then pray into. One of the things that struck me very strongly was the major events, institutions that are shutting down because of this. And, you know, it's like all the sporting events, the NBA, the NHL, the Major League Baseball, all shut down. The colleges not only shut down the sporting events, but they're doing online learning for the rest of the year. Just what came to me about this was the people who are making these decisions are losing a lot of money. All right. Now, you may think, they should. But that's the point. People are willing to put aside the finances just to save the lives of people. And so what I saw in that was that we should begin to pray that the whole world, or at least the United States where this is happening, it was probably happening in the whole world, that people would begin to see how much we value life. Doesn't matter that we're going to lose $30 million because we stopped this event, if we save a life because we stopped this event. So let's just pray into that. And then there's another one that I want to pray into. So, Father, we pray that as people see these things canceled that are costing those organizations and people who put them on millions and millions of dollars, cruise ships sitting in dock, airlines sitting in hangars, the entertainment events, the sporting events, Broadway shut down. Nobody's complaining that they're losing money. Everybody is saying this is more important. It's more important to save lives than to make this money. And we pray that that attitude, that revelation would just begin to touch people's hearts and just increase the value that we place on life in our culture. In Yeshua's name. The other thing that I wanted to share a little bit about and then pray into is that one of the things that's happening with this coronavirus is there's no source of help. Doctors can't really help you. There's no medication for it, right? Governments are just trying to help you stop getting it, but there's nothing they can do once you get it. If you have a lot of money, it's not going to help you with this. You can't even travel anywhere to get away. If you were like living in Washington, where actually there's a Messianic congregation in Washington, I'm getting updates like every two or three times a day on what they're having to do. They're shut down completely, everything. So if you had a lot of money, you couldn't even get a plane out of Seattle right now to go somewhere else. So there's no help in anything natural. You see where I'm going with this? Where is the only help? The only help is just in the Lord. Yami just told me, incredible, Monroe County just announced all schools are closed. So, amazing. So, again, there's no help. There's no help. The only help is in. So, listen to this verse, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16. Paul is talking about the veil that covers people's hearts that prevents them from seeing the good news, that prevents us from seeing the spirit world and seeing the Messiah. And he says this, but says the Torah, whenever someone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. So, see where I'm going with this? Let's pray that all of those who are turning to the Lord because of this crisis, that they would have the veil taken away from their hearts and they would be able to see through to the truth of the gospel. So, Father, we know your ways are not our ways. Your thoughts are not our thoughts. And we're looking at this crisis like it's a terrible thing and everybody's struggling with it. But who knows? This could be the way that you bring revival
to so much of the world because there's no hope. There's no hope in anything right now, in anything that we have put our hopes in. There's no hope only in you. So we pray, Lord, that as people turn to you, whether it's because a loved one is sick or they're sick or they're in quarantine. I can't even imagine what it's going to be like to be in quarantine for 2 weeks. But they're stir crazy. They've got cabin fever. They're going nuts. They turn to you in the midst of that. Your word says the veil is removed. And we know so much of the world, although Paul is talking about the Jewish people, and we want to see the veil removed from Jewish people. Obviously, that's our first priority. But there's a veil over all people that they're not seeing the good news. They're not seeing the gospel. And we agree together right now, Lord, in the name of Yeshua, that the veil would be removed from the Jewish people here in Rochester, from all the people here in Rochester, and all around the world. This is a big prayer, that this veil would be removed, and instead they would see through to your grace, to your spirit. And we pray this in Yeshua's name. And Diane has something?
Well, it's not really from the Lord. It's sort of from me. But I would like to pray for the homeless and the poor. They have nothing. They are so compromised. Their health is horrible. Some of them are on drugs. They live with rats. I mean, they have nothing, absolutely nothing. And if this hits the homeless community, I mean, we're in really bad shape, and they need the Lord desperately. So can we just agree that they would accept him in this time? Lord, we just pray for the homeless, that you would protect them and bring them to you through this, that people would be generous and find them places to live so that they can don't have to live with rats and garbage, and that they will, the city would realize, the country would realize, that if they don't take care of the homeless, that's a breeding ground. So they should do something to clean that up and get them to safety. And we ask that your spirit would flow through there, that they would accept you in droves, that they would realize that, like James said, there isn't any hope in anybody but you. You're our hope and our salvation. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Diana. Let's pray for parents and children, because not only are it's going to be quarantined, but it sounds like parents will be home, children will be home with their parents for we don't know how long. So, Lord, we just lift up all of those families with children in the schools of Monroe County and other school districts that are now facing closed schools. And we don't know for how long. The kids are home. Parents who are working, what are they doing? Going to do with their kids? They're going to have to be home with them. This is a huge complication. And again, people will be, there's no help. There's nobody you can hire because there's all this going around. So we pray that that veil would be taken away also from them. And Father, we just want to lift up some of the people in our congregation who are compromised health situation. For Julia, who's going through chemotherapy, for Sam, who's recovering from chemotherapy, and for Julio, who's recovering from surgery, we ask for your hand to be upon them, to keep them safe, to keep them from this. For others who are suffering, Ann Malik hasn't been here in a long time. She's got health issues. I just heard that the people who run this building, Robert and Deborah, they're both not allowed in the building because they have both got help. Robert's going through chemotherapy. He just finished. And because Deborah is with him, neither of them can be in the building. So the management of this building now is facing trying to run the building without anybody running it. So we lift up Robert and Deborah to you also, Father, and pray for your hand to be upon them. And also for Brighton Presbyterian Church and those who are tasked, my friend Gene, who's overseeing the running of this building. We just pray for wisdom and for help for him, because we may be locked out at some point if they can't maintain the building. So we lift all that up to you, Lord. We got so many prayers here. We're only looking to you because it's only in you that we have any hope. And we also want to pray, Father, for Israel right now, because in the midst of all this, they're still trying to form a government. They don't have a government. And Tuesday, the trial of Prime Minister Netanyahu is about to start. And it's just, we think it's crazy here. It's really crazy there. So we pray, Father, for your hand to be upon the people of Israel and the government of Israel to bring them through this time. And we thank you, Father, for what you're going to do through all of this, because we know that you make everything work together for good to them who love you. And we just stand on that promise, Lord, that you're going to even work this for good. And Father, we just thank you that we can look into your word now. And we thank you for Pastor Tom. We thank you for the anointing that you've placed Tom in the past. We believe your anointing is on him in this time, and we ask for your anointing to just touch him in a special way right now to bring this forth in the way that you want to bring it forth. And we also ask, Lord, that you would open up our ears to hear, our eyes to see, our minds to understand, our hearts to receive, and our wills to obey whatever it is that is going to be in his word. And we bind the power of the enemy right now to bring any disruption, to bring any deception, to make any way in which we would be blocked from receiving what you're going to speak through Pastor Tom. In Yeshua's awesome name, amen.
Up so I can see a little bit. You know, here's a true story. This was in Reader's Digest. A woman who works at Department of Motor Vehicles said a man was in the line. He wanted a personalized license plate with his wedding anniversary on it. As we completed the paperwork, he said, "This way, I can't forget the date." A few hours later, I recognized the same young man waiting in my lane. When his turn came, he somewhat sheepishly said, "I need to change the numbers on my plate application." Wrong date. Oh, well, that's too bad, isn't it? Well, the title today is What Am I Doing? And it goes hand in hand. I'm trying to write a book, so I'm announcing it so everybody can hound me, and now I have to work on it. This is one of the chapters. Kind of timely. I've been planning it for a while, but now in the wake of coronavirus, we're changing a lot of things that we're doing, aren't we? And this is true for both individuals and communities. This virus outbreak confirms that what we're doing has a great impact on ourselves and on other people's. When asking the question, what am I doing? There's two aspects to the question. Am I doing what I should be doing? And am I not doing what I should not be doing? If the answer is yes, then I'm doing what's necessary to please God and to be free in Messiah. But the opposite question would be, am I doing what I should not be doing? And am I not doing what I should be doing? And if the answer is yes to these questions, then I'm probably not pleasing God. I'm in spiritual bondage, and the intensity of the mind fight is increasing. See, when we're doing something we should not be doing, we should stop doing it. We tell our children, stop that. But if we're not doing something we should be doing, we should start doing it. And I know that sounds relatively simple, but it's also very important. Now, in the previous message, I asked the question, what am I wanting? And made the point that what we are wanting can put us into spiritual bondage and lead us into sin when we are wanting what God does not want us to want. We often do only what we want to do and avoid doing what we don't want to do, or at least that's the way we try to live, isn't it? As parents of newborns, we find out very quickly that we can't live that way. And usually, it's not really a good way to live. God instructs us to do things that are good for us and to not do things that are harmful to us, no matter how we feel or how we think about those things. Doing is important. We should strive to do the things God tells us to do, whether or not we want to do them. And we should strive to not do the things that God tells us not to do, whether or not we want to do them. Now, God promises to bless us if we are obedient to him. This is all about doing. Deuteronomy 28, verses 1 through 3 tell us, now listen, if you listen obediently to the voice of Adonai your God, taking care to do all his mitzvot that I am commanding you today, Adonai your God will set you on high above all the nations of the earth. Then all these blessings will come upon you and overtake you if you listen to the voice of Adonai your God. Blessed will you be in the city and blessed will you be in the field. Now Moses goes on to list the blessings that will come upon us if we are obedient, if we do what God tells us. Here are some of them. We'll be blessed with children, animals, agriculture. We'll have plenty of food, victory over enemies. God will bless whatever we do. We will have rain. We will lend and not borrow. We will be the head and not the tail. Can you see? These blessings are dependent on what we are doing, if we are doing what God tells us to do. And many of these blessings are physical in nature, but we'll see that they also result in spiritual blessings. But Moses also told us what we should not be doing. Deuteronomy 28, verses 15 and 16 tell us, but if you will not listen to the voice of Adonai your God to take care to do all his mitzvot and statutes that I am commanding you today, all these curses will come on you and overtake you. Cursed will you be in the city, cursed will you be in the field. Now his curses include food, agriculture, and livestock, as well as confusion and frustration in everything you do. He says there will be all sorts of illnesses, including weaknesses, fever, inflammation, boils, hemorrhoids, scabs, itching, along with terrible prolonged plagues, severe prolonged illnesses, including illnesses and plagues that are not written in Torah. There will be psychological disorders, including madness, confusion of heart, and fear. There's a lot of that going around today, isn't there? Those under the curse will only be oppressed and crushed and defeated by enemies. And instead of prospering, there will be robbery and crime. It says your children will go into captivity, outsiders will rule over you, you will be the borrower and not the lender, and the tail instead of the head. People will fight against each other, and eventually you'll be taken into captivity. Many of these curses are physical in nature. For example, sickness and crime. Things like the coronavirus outbreak can be considered among the curses that are mentioned. It is a plague, and you might be wondering, is the corona outbreak virus a curse? Well, it certainly isn't a blessing, is it? People are doing things to abate the outbreak. We're changing our interaction with each other. We're sanitizing ourselves and our surroundings in order to minimize the spread. And these are all good things to do. But if we turn from doing what brings the curses to doing what brings the blessings, it can only help. Do you agree? It's something every one of us can do. Now, please understand, I'm not telling you about the curses to cause fear. I'm telling you because it's written in God's Torah. Also, God tells us how to have the blessings in our lives instead of the curses by doing what he says to do. Now, this may be different from what we want to do, or what we feel like doing, or what we think we should do. But if we want the blessings, we need to disregard our wants, our feelings, and those thoughts, and do what God says to do. The blessings apply not only to us personally, but to those around us, to our community. See, the Centers for Disease Control has been giving advice for dealing with the coronavirus, but long ago, the head of the Center for Sin Control, God himself, gave this advisory. 2 Chronicles 7, verses 13 and 14. He says, if I shut up heaven that there is no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people, when my people over whom my name is called humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their evil ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. Now, the word pestilence isn't one we often use. It's not common, but I looked it up. Collins English Dictionary calls pestilence, quote, any epidemic outbreak of a deadly and highly infectious disease such as the plague, end quote. According to Random House, Kurneman Webster's College Dictionary, pestilence is, quote, a deadly or virulent epidemic disease, end quote. I think it's pretty safe to say that COVID-19, the current coronavirus outbreak, conforms to those definitions. Would you agree? Do you realize that as God's people, we can have a positive impact on the health and the welfare of our community and our nation if we turn from our evil ways? That's one of the four things that he tells us to do. Humble ourselves, pray, seek his face, and turn from our wicked ways. He will heal the land. And I'm going to discuss what our evil ways are shortly, and you might be surprised to find that some of the things are not what you think. You know, what we do can be an incredibly important ingredient to the things that keep us in bondage. If we never did the things we're in bondage to, they would never have had an opportunity to get power over us. For example, there are probably no alcoholics or drug addicts who grew up wishing to be in bondage to a substance. Now, some substances are highly addictive and can almost instantly result in an addiction. If you never used it, you would never be addicted. And I understand that some prescription medications can result in addiction, even though the intent of the medication was for healing. But most of the time, however, alcoholism and addiction to some substances occurs after a certain amount of time abusing the substance. The addiction would never have happened if the substance had not been misused, if they had not done what they did. The point is, the overwhelming majority of addiction is the end result of doing what should not have been done. So what we do is of critical importance. As followers of Messiah, what we do is extremely important spiritually. Yeshua said in John chapter 14, verse 15, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. The implication is that if we are not doing what Yeshua tells us to do, or we are not doing what he tells us to not to do, we do not love him. Let me say it again. If we're not doing what he tells us to do, or we're doing what he tells us not to do, we don't love him, and we can say it all we want. But there's more implications. 1 John chapter 2, starting at verse 3, tells us, now we know that we have come to know him by this, if we keep his commandments. The one who says, I have come to know him, and does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, in him the love of God is truly made perfect. We know that we are in him by this. Whoever claims to abide in him must walk just as he walked. John is saying, if we're not obeying Yeshua, the truth is not in us. We're not abiding with him. And this puts us into spiritual bondage. In chapter 8 of the book of John, verses 31 and 32, John tells us, Yeshua said to the Judeans who had trusted in him, if you abide in my word, then you are truly my disciples. You will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. So it's obvious if I'm living a lie by not keeping his commandments, I can never be free from spiritual bondage. If we want to be free from spiritual bondage and decrease the intensity of the mind fight, obeying Yeshua is not an option. It's mandatory. We have to change some things that we're doing. See, my proposition is this. Doing things that God instructs us to do will result in blessings, including spiritual freedom, while not doing things he instructs us to do and doing things he prohibits will result in curses and spiritual bondage and will increase the intensity of the mind fight. So the first point I want to make is what I am doing could be evil. Before we look at what we're supposed to do, I want to discuss a few things we're not supposed to do. Now, most of us sitting here have some idea of what is good and what is evil. However, the definitions of good and evil can change over time in any society that's not fully grounded in God's word. We can see that clearly today as we look at the slipping moral standards and values all around us. The definition of evil is changing, but God's definition never changes. See, most of us would probably say, we're pretty good, and we avoid evil. But again, I want to look at what God says is evil in the Bible and use that measure. The Hebrew word ra in the Bible is often translated as evil, sometimes as wickedness or wicked. It can mean mischief, hurt, bad, trouble. The word ra is used 664 times in 623 verses. Now, today we're going to thoroughly examine each one of the 623 verses. No, I'm kidding. We're not going to. I already did that for you. I want to take a close look at some of the verses that describe the word ra so we can understand what God calls evil, and we can turn from it if we find it in ourselves so that he can heal our land. The first use of ra in the Bible is in Genesis, describing the tree of good and evil. And the second use, God gives a command to Adam and also gives a warning of what will happen when he breaks a command. Genesis 2, verses 16 and 17. Then Adonai Elohim commanded the man, saying, "From all the trees of the garden you are most welcome to eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil," or ra, "you must not eat, for when you eat from it, you will most assuredly die." I think we can say God takes evil pretty seriously and warns Adam, eating from this tree will cause his death. Now, we know that was a spiritual death. It pulled him away from God. But later we learn the evil, ra, had spread all over the earth. Genesis 6, verse 5. Adonai saw that the wickedness of humankind was great on the earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of their heart was only evil, ra, all of the time. Again, the Hebrew word ra is translated as wickedness and evil in this version and many others. Adonai saw the ra in the world was bad, and that the thoughts and intentions were ra. Again, notice how seriously God takes ra. It is something that merits the destruction of the earth when everyone is doing ra. Later, the city of Sodom was singled out for destruction because the people of Sodom were ra. Genesis 13, verse 13 says, "But the people of Sodom were evil, ra, very great sinners against Adonai." Now, later, Ezekiel told us the evil ra was a combination of things, including pride, gluttony, idleness, disregard for the poor and needy, and abomination, most likely referring to the sexual immorality and homosexuality mentioned in the account of Sodom's destruction. A little later in the Bible, when Joseph was propositioned by the wife of his master, he referred to adultery as being great ra. And he also referred to the act of his brothers selling him into slavery as ra, evil. The next example of ra might cause all of us to shudder just a little bit. Numbers 14, verses 26 and 27. Adonai then said to Moses and Aaron, saying, "How long will this wicked, ra, community be grumbling against me? For I have heard the complaints of Bnei Yisrael grumbling against me." That word wicked, ra, apparently grumbling or murmuring or complaining against God is in the category of ra. Have you ever complained against God? I have. The grumbling was enough for God to decide that all the adults who murmured against him would die in the wilderness and not be allowed to enter the promised land. See, ra can be a lot more serious than we think it is. Some other uses of ra in the Bible without hitting all the verses: serving other gods and worshiping them, testifying falsely against someone or lying, a stubborn and rebellious son who's a drunken and a drunkard and a glutton, extramarital sex, adultery, sexual immorality, worshiping idols, making shrines from them, making images, having your sons and daughters pass through the fire, the ancient version of abortion, practicing divination and enchantment, practicing witchcraft, divination, sorcery, consulting ghosts and spiritists, refusing to serve God the way he says to serve him, putting things that God prohibits into his house, marrying foreign women. Now, this likely refers to marrying unbelievers, not those of a different nationality. Profaning Yom Shabbat, not keeping the Sabbath. Now, many of us wouldn't consider this necessarily evil, but God calls it Ra. You may not recognize any of the evil things described in you. You may say, well, I haven't done any of those. However, Yeshua tells us we can do evil in our hearts without physically doing what God calls evil. For example, the Torah calls adultery ra, evil. Here's what Yeshua says about adultery. Matthew 25, verses 27 and 28. You have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I tell you that everyone who looks upon a woman to lust after her has already committed adultery with her in his heart. That doesn't just apply to men looking at women. It's applying to anyone looking at another person with a desire that they shouldn't have. I think we can all admit that we've done some evil or some ra in our lives, can't we? The second point I want to make is what I am doing could be wicked. Now, I suppose most of us here today wouldn't consider ourselves to be wicked in any way. We do some wrong things, maybe some bad things, but wickedness, that's only the most ungodly and perverse people. Or so we think. Again, I want to look at what God calls wicked in the Bible and use that as our measure. So the Hebrew word, rasha, means wicked or ungodly. It means moral wrong. Here are some verses that tell us some things that are wicked or rasha. Psalm 119, verse 53. Burning indignation grips me because of the wicked who forsake your Torah. Proverbs 21, verse 4. Haughty eyes and a proud heart, the lamp of the wicked is sin. You see, forsaking God's Torah, being haughty and proud and loving sin, is wicked. But so many people think, I know better than what the Bible says. That's wickedness. Proverbs 10:11, the mouth of the righteous is a fountain of life, but the mouth of the wicked, rasha, conceals violence. And Proverbs 10:32, the lips of the righteous know what is pleasing, but the mouth of the wicked, or rasha, is perverse. Speaking perversely, concealing violence with speech, is wicked, or rasha. Proverbs 12:10, a righteous person cares for the life of his animal, yet even the compassion of the rasha, wicked, is cruel. And a righteous person considers justice for the poor. The wicked, rasha, one, has no such concern. According to God, cruelty to animals and lack of concern for the poor are wicked, rasha. Psalm 37:21. The wicked, rasha, borrows and does not repay, but the righteous is a gracious giver. And Proverbs 17, verse 23, the wicked, rasha, one, receives a bribe in secret to pervert the ways of justice. Now, I think we would all probably agree receiving a bribe to pervert justice is wicked. But please note, in God's eyes, it is also wicked to not repay what we have borrowed. Does that include my library book? I'll let you think that over and work it out with God. Other uses of rasha in the Bible, acting in shameful disgrace and not hating lying, being a malicious witness. Do we see any of that going on today? Rebelling against the authority God has put in place over you, persecuting the poor, boasting, renouncing God, hating instruction and approving of stealing and adultery, lying and using hateful words, and of course, murder. Now, I would agree with that one very much. We can probably all agree that murder is wicked, can't we? But again, Yeshua comes along and gives us some other instruction about the true nature of murder. Matthew 5, verses 21 and 22, you have heard it was said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever commits murder shall be subject to the judgment. But I tell you that everyone who is angry with his brother shall be subject to judgment, and whoever says to his brother, Raca, shall be subject to the council, and whoever says, you fool, shall be subject to fiery Gehenna. Ever been angry with someone? I think it's fair to say that we've all been wicked at one time or another, isn't it? See, my first point is about looking at what I'm doing. What I'm doing could be evil. What I'm doing could be wicked. But I want to make a third point. What I am doing could be not evil. See, we all have a choice to put the ra or evil out of our lives. And it's critical to recognize the ra or evil in our lives because ra does not live with God. Psalms 5, verses 4 and 5. Adonai, in the morning you hear my voice. In the morning I order my prayer before you and watch expectantly. For you are not a God who rejoices in evil. No wickedness, ra, dwells in you. Understanding and admitting we've done evil or ra is the first step in correcting and improving our relationship with God. See, Adam did evil by eating the fruit and he died. We can turn from evil and live. Isn't that great? We have to just know what God says is evil and recognize it. Turning from evil is the next step. God promises blessings if we do that. Psalm 37, verses 27, 28. Turn from evil, ra, and do good so that you may live forever. For Adonai loves justice and does not abandon his godly ones. They will be preserved forever, but the seed of the wicked will be cut off. When we turn from our evil and begin trusting fully in Adonai, we will no longer have to fear the evil, the ra, that is in the world. Psalms 23, verses 1 through 4, a psalm of David. We all know this. Adonai is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Ra, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff comforts me. And here's an important one. Turning from evil, or ra, also gives physical healing. Proverbs 3, verses 7 and 8. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear Adonai and turn from ra, from evil. It will be healing to your body and refreshment to your bones. See, we can make the choice that what we're doing is not going to be evil. The fourth point I want to make is what I am doing could be not wicked. Choosing to do wicked things brings sorrow, but trusting in Adonai brings loving kindness. Psalms 32, verse 10. Many are the sorrows of the wicked, Rasha, but loving kindness surrounds the one who trusts in Adonai. Wickedness also interferes with our relationship with God. It robs our shalom or our peace. Isaiah 57, verses 20 and 21. But the wicked, Rasha, are like a troubled sea, for it cannot rest. Its waters toss up mire and dirt. There is no shalom, says my God, for the wicked, Rasha. No rest, no peace. The difference between righteousness and wickedness in our life is like the difference between light and darkness. Proverbs 4, verses 18 and 19. The path of the righteous is like the light of dawn, shining brighter and brighter until the full day. The way of the wicked, Rasha, is darkness. They do not even know what makes them stumble. And finally, even the sacrifices and prayers of the wicked are abominations to Adonai, but choosing not to do wicked things allows our prayer to be heard. Proverbs 15, verses 8 and 9. The sacrifice of the Rasha, wicked, is an abomination to Adonai, but the prayer of the upright pleases him. Adonai detests the way of the Rasha, the wicked, but loves those who pursue righteousness. So clearly, doing wicked things leads us into spiritual bondage and increases the intensity of the mind fight. We have a choice in the things we do. But there's something even better than just stopping the evil and the wicked things we're doing. See, my first point, what I am doing could be evil. Second, what I am doing could be wicked. What I am doing could be not evil. Fourth, what I am doing could be not wicked. And five, what I am doing could be righteous. See, earlier I discussed how Yeshua said if we love him, we'll keep his commandments. Our freedom in Messiah is dependent on what we are doing. It is dependent on keeping his commandments. And if I don't keep his commandments, I will never have my spiritual freedom. In fact, Yeshua is not really our Lord unless we're choosing to do what he tells us to do. See, similar to the blessings and curses listed in Deuteronomy 28, keeping Yeshua's commands will bring blessings, and not keeping them will bring curses. Look what Scripture has to say. Luke 6, verses 46 through 49. Yeshua says, "Why do you call me Master, Master, and do not do what I say? Everyone who comes to me and hears my words and does them," have you all heard his words? "Everyone who comes to me and hears my words and does them, I will show you what he is like. He is like a man building a house who dug deep and laid a foundation on the rock. And when a flood came, the torrent burst against the house, but it could not shake it because it had been well built. But the one who hears yet does not do is like a man who built a house upon land without a foundation. When the torrent burst against it, immediately it collapsed, and the destruction of that house was great." Do you feel like your life is being shaken sometimes? Like the torrent is coming against you and you're not able to stand? Perhaps you've heard his words and maybe there's some you're not doing. I've found that in my life from time to time. Most of us have heard his words, but I want to go over some of them so that we can have our houses built on a rock and decrease the intensity of the mind fight. Now, a lawyer asked Yeshua what the greatest commandment was. Matthew 22, verses 37 through 40, he says, Yeshua said to him, "You shall love Adonai your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. The entire Torah and prophets hang on these two commands." Yeshua is reaffirming the commands from the Torah that tell us to love God with all our heart and all our soul and all our mind and to love our neighbor as ourselves. They still stand. They haven't gone away. We demonstrate our love for God and Yeshua by keeping his commands, all of them. The Pharisees were great at keeping some of God's commands, but there were some that they ignored on a regular basis. Loving God and neighbor is not just about what we are saying or how we're thinking or what we feel. It is about what we are doing. And the entire Bible, according to Yeshua, rests on these commands. Now, within a family, for instance, we can tell our children, our parents, our brothers, our sisters, we love them, and we can even have wonderful thoughts about them. But what really counts is how we treat each other. What we do to and for each other is what really demonstrates the love. Our actions demonstrate our love. God has done things to show his love. He didn't just talk about it or have thoughts about us. And perhaps the greatest demonstration of love is coming as the man Yeshua HaMashiach. Romans 5, verse 8. God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Messiah died for us. Yeshua tells us how to demonstrate love for each other with what we call the golden rule. Matthew 7, verse 12. So in all things, do to others what you would want them to do to you, for this is the Torah and the prophets. The whole Bible depends on doing to others the way I want them to do to me. It's all about doing. Now, Confucius reportedly said, don't do to others what you don't want done unto you. This concerns not doing something, and many laws are about not doing something. But Yeshua took it to the next level and made it about doing, not just abstaining. It's not enough to not be rude or nasty because I don't want someone to be rude or nasty to me. We should be kind because we want to be treated with kindness. That's what we do. This is what doing is. We should love others, including the unlovable, because we want to be loved. That's the golden rule. That's what brings peace, shalom, freedom. That's what brings the blessings and pushes the curses away. But Yeshua didn't stop at loving our God and our neighbor. Matthew 5, 43 through 48 says, "You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy." Now, I want to pause for a second because the Torah does not command us to hate our enemy. Perhaps this way of thinking was derived from Psalm 139, where David says that he hates those who hate God. But God doesn't tell us to hate our enemies. In any case, Yeshua clarified what our position should be. Verses 44 and 45, "I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous." Yeshua is saying that we are not God's children if we don't love and pray for our enemies. This doesn't mean we ignore justice or good or evil. It means that we treat others, including our enemies, as though they are human beings made in the image of God with love and respect. It doesn't mean we don't call the police when somebody's breaking into our house. God is a God of justice, and he also wants justice done on earth. That's why he gave rules and commands about it. Yeshua goes on, starting at verse 46, "For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Even the tax collectors do the same, don't they? And if you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than anyone else? Even the pagans do that, don't they? Therefore, be perfect, just as your Father in heaven is perfect." Is he really commanding us to be perfect? Really? Is that even possible? Let me ask, how hard are you trying to be perfect? How often do you confess your failure to be perfect before Adonai and receive his forgiveness for it? Or do we just say, I'm not perfect, it doesn't matter? Yeshua further clarified how we should treat those who are against us. Matthew 5, verses 38 and 39, "You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evildoer. But whoever slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him also the other." Again, Yeshua is not saying the law or the Torah no longer applies. The principle of eye for eye and tooth for tooth was for the government as a guideline to make righteous judgments, to make sure the punishment fits the crime. Yeshua is not speaking to the government here. He's speaking to people who are being governed, giving a guideline about how we treat others. See, a slap on the cheek is a relatively minor offense that usually doesn't result in a judgment by the government. We should overlook minor offenses. Forgiving somebody if they steal my car doesn't mean I say, well, okay, you can keep it. And turning the other cheek doesn't mean I say, here's the keys to my wife's car too. Okay? Justice is justice. God is a God of justice. But for my part, I don't hate or condemn or treat the person evilly who stole my car. I can still call the police and get my car back. Does that make sense? Other things Yeshua has told us to do: give more than what's asked of us. Lend to others. Forgive as we want to be forgiven. Judge the same way we want to be judged, with the same measure. Be compassionate, just as our Father is compassionate. Give. Repent. Keep your word. Seek God's kingdom. Beware of false prophets. Fear only God. Honor your parents. Take Yeshua's yoke upon yourself. Deny yourself. Be a servant. Pay taxes. Make disciples. Honor marriage. Pray for laborers. Love one another. Be salt and light to the world. Please notice, Yeshua gives a lot more than 10 commandments. I want to look at how we apply what we just went over today. As God's people, we have an opportunity to do things not only for our own physical and spiritual health, but also for our community. According to the prophet Ezekiel, God said this, written in Ezekiel 22, verses 29 to 31, "The people of the land have oppressively blackmailed, plundered in robbery, wronged the poor and needy, and abused the outsider unjustly. I searched for someone among them who would build up the wall and stand in the breach before me for the land so that I would not destroy it, but I found no one. Therefore, I have poured out my fury on them. I have consumed them with the fire of my wrath. I have brought their own way upon their heads." It is a declaration of Adonai. Many of the versions, instead of saying stand in the breach, they say stand in the gap. Here's my question. Are you ready, as God's people, to stand in the gap and turn from evil ways so that our land can be healed? We have a unique opportunity to serve our community in a unique way today, right here and right now, by standing in the gap. See, we often do things simply because we want to do them. And likewise, we sometimes do things because we don't want to do them. But again, we should be doing what God tells us to do and not doing what God tells us not to do. When we have done evil, ra, or wicked, rasha, things, we expose ourselves and our community to physical problems and spiritual bondage. I'd like us all to pray this prayer and ask God to reveal any evil or wicked ways that we might have done so that we can confess, renounce, and repent. Everybody ready? Dear Heavenly Father, I know that you have told me to avoid evil and wickedness for my own good. I confess that I have done things that are evil and that are wicked. Please bring to my mind the evil and wicked things I have done so I can confess and turn away from them. In Yeshua's holy name, amen. On the next slide, I have some of the evil and wicked things we should not be doing. See if the Lord touches you with any of these. Pride, gluttony, idleness, disregard for the poor, misusing drugs or alcohol, pornography, sexual immorality, adultery, actual adultery or in the heart, murder, actual or in the heart, grumbling against God, a false testimony, profaning Yom Shabbat, forsaking the Torah, foul language, malice, lying, speaking hateful words, rebelling against authority, having false gods or idols, not paying what I owe, and maybe the Lord has put some other things on your heart. For each of those items that you've identified, I'd like us all to pray a prayer to confess and renounce them. This next prayer, Lord Yeshua, I confess that I have done things that you've said are evil or wicked. I have, tell the Lord what things he's laid on your heart and confess it back to him. And then let's continue. I renounce doing these evil and wicked things, and I ask you to forgive me. I repent from doing them and ask you to cancel any ground that Satan has gained in my life and in my community. Amen. The next prayer that I'd like us all to pray together is to ask God to reveal ways that we have not obeyed. Everybody ready? Dear Heavenly Father, I know that you have given me commands for my own good and obeying your commands is how I show my love for you. You sent your son, Yeshua, to demonstrate your love for us, and we show our love by keeping his commands. Please bring to my mind all of your commands that I am not keeping. In Yeshua's holy name, amen. And next, I have a list of Yeshua's commands I should be doing. Love God, love others, repent, fear only God, be compassionate, keep my word, be perfect, be a servant, give abundantly, don't worry, lend, forgive others, make disciples, be salt and light to the world, don't be angry with others, judge as I want to be judged, honor marriage, honor parents, pray for laborers, love and pray for enemies, turn the other cheek, don't lust after others, seek God's kingdom, treat others as I want to be treated, beware of false prophets, and if there's any other commands that he lays on your heart. For each of those, let's pray together to the Lord. Lord Yeshua, I confess that I have not kept these commands of yours. Name them to him. And continuing, I renounce my lack of obedience as being sinful and ungodly, and I repent of not loving you by not keeping your commands. I choose now to show my love for you by doing all you have told me to do. And finally, let's thank God for the work he is doing in all of us. Father in heaven, thank you for your word that says you will bring blessings to me and my community when I obey your commands. I choose to devote myself to obeying you, and I thank you for replacing the curses in my life and in my community with your blessings. In the precious name of Yeshua, I pray, amen. See, now it's up to all of us to keep putting this in practice, to keep examining what we're doing and not take a measure of evil or wickedness based on what we think or the surrounding world thinks, but on what God thinks. To keep putting those things out of our life if we catch ourselves doing it, to confess and repent and turn away from it. And as 2 Chronicles 7:14 says, if we humble ourselves and we pray, and we seek God's face. In other words, whatever I'm doing, what would be the look on God's face if he stood here looking at me right now? We seek his face and we turn from these evil ways, he will heal our land. Now, do you believe that we can make an impact on the community by just what we did here today, that we can bring a healing? Amen. Now, I think a lot of people have some fear going on in this coronavirus. Is that fair to say? I have a declaration that I'd like us all to read from Psalm 91. This is based on Psalm 91, and instead of having yous, it is I. So let's all say this together. Because I am dwelling in the secret place of the Most High, I am abiding under the shadow of the Almighty. I am saying of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him I will trust. Surely he shall deliver me from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. He shall cover me with his feathers, and under his wings I shall take refuge. His truth shall be my shield and buckler. I shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day, nor of the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor of the destruction that lays waste at noonday. 1,000 may fall at my side, and 10,000 at my right hand, but it shall not come near me. Only with my eyes shall I look and see the reward of the wicked. Because I have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, my dwelling places. No evil shall befall me, nor shall any plague come near my dwelling, For he shall give his angels charge over me to keep me in all my ways. In their hands they shall bear me up, lest I dash my foot against a stone. I shall tread upon the lion and the cobra, the young lion and the serpent I shall trample underfoot. Because I have set my love upon God, therefore God will deliver me. God will set me on high because I have known his name. I shall call upon God and God will answer me. God will be with me in trouble. God will deliver me and honor me with long life. God will satisfy me and show me his salvation. Ben. Ben. Now again, the devil came and tried to use that on Yeshua. He took him up to the pinnacle of the temple and he said, throw yourself down, because God gave his angels charge over, this is the King Tom version, God gave his angels charge over you to bear you up in all your ways. Okay? But it's to bear you up in your ways, in doing the righteousness before God. The angels are here for us. They are here to help us to stay in God's ways. The question is, do we believe it? The question is, will we find these evil things and turn from them, humble ourselves, pray, seek God's face, and see a change in our community and in the nation and in the world as people of God, those called by his name? That's what we're here for. We are here for such a time as this. So, Abba, Father, I just thank you that you have given blessings and you have told us how to receive those blessings, that you want to pour out blessings on us. I thank you that you have described the curses and you have told us clearly what causes the curses so that we can turn from those things and have a closer relationship with you. I thank you, Abba Father, for the healing that you are going to bring in this community. I thank you that as I stay under the shelter of you, under your wings, that I stay close to you, that you will protect us from the plague that is out there, that we have no reason as your children to fear as long as we are walking in harmony with you, under your feathers, in your temple, being the children that you call us to be. So help us to be what you call us to be. Remind us of any areas where we are failing and help us to have the grace to turn, to repent, to confess, and stand up and walk with you in the mighty name of our Lord, our Redeemer, Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen.
All right, a couple announcements, as usual. If you are a first-time visitor, please see Rabbi Jim afterwards. He'd love to meet you and talk to you, answer any questions that you have. So he'll be available probably back there. We do have a prayer team, so if anyone has any concerns or would like prayer for anything, they will be available up here. Also first-time visitors can bring their guest cards to Don if they have not already received their free gift. And we do have some groceries in the kitchen, so if you need them or if you know of anyone, especially if you know someone elderly or immune compromised that could maybe use a loaf of bread or a carton of eggs or something, this would be a great thing to pick up for them so they don't have to go out. There are no children to pick up because they're all here. Or no, you've got, well, whatever the case. Yep, okay. I think we've covered all of that. Also, Passover is coming up. That's still on as of this moment. Registration for Passover will start next week after service. I believe the bulletins right now have, I didn't even get a bulletin today. They have a flyer in it, and I believe that you can fill it out. You can also go online at any time and register that way. So you are welcome to fill that out today if you'd like, or go online. And bring it back next week. Or go online, and then you don't have to keep track of a piece of paper. Even better. All right. Please rise, and we will conclude with the Vene Mar and the benediction. Vene Mar Vahaya Adonai Lemelech Olko Haaretz Bayom Hahu Bayom Hahu Yeh Adonai Echad Ushemo 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 Echad. And it is said, and the Lord shall be king over all the earth. In that day shall the Lord be one, and his name one. Amen. Now, normally, we would all kind of be gathering at this point for the benediction. I do not encourage that, but do it in your hearts. We're all supporting each other. Yes, yes, you can touch feet, Ethel. We're all supporting each other in this time especially, but always. So please receive this blessing and bless those around you from a distance with it. Yivarech Adonai ve'yishmarecha Ya'ed Adonai panav elecha V'chuneka Yisa Adonai Panav Elecha Ve'asem Lecha Shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and place his peace within you. In the name of Yeshua, our Messiah. Amen.
Stay tuned for a short closing message from Rabbi Jim Appel.
Shalom. I'm Messianic Rabbi Jim Appel, and I hope you enjoyed our TV program. It was produced for you by Congregation Shema Yisrael, a Messianic Jewish synagogue. Shema Yisrael is a congregation of Jewish and non-Jewish people who worship the God of Israel while maintaining our Jewish identity and lifestyle, and who believe that Yeshua, whose English name is Jesus, is Israel's promised Messiah. Shema Yisrael's purposes are to proclaim Yeshua as Messiah to Jewish and non-Jewish people and help them connect personally with the God of Israel through worship. We welcome you to join our mishpacha, or family, and connect with your Jewish roots. I'd love to meet you personally at one of our weekly Shabbat services or at one of our special events where people from all backgrounds are welcome. Shalom.
We hope you enjoyed today's teaching. Call our office to request a copy on videotape. If you would like more information about Messianic Judaism or Shema Yisrael, please call us at 585-288-0670 or visit our website at www.shemayisrael.org. where you can find a listing of upcoming special events. Please join us for our weekly Shabbat service. Saturday morning, complete children's program interpretation for the deaf is available. Please notify us in advance if it is needed. Congregation Shema Yisrael also sponsors Bengals and Blessings, a Messianic music and talk radio program with Ethel Chadwick. You can also hear Bengals and Blessings by going to our website, www.shemayisrael.org, or bagelsandblessings.com. Please join us for our Messianic Judaism class, Israeli dance class, Hebrew class, or youth group. Call the office for hours and locations. Tune in next week when Re'eh Yisrael will again bring you teachings from the scriptures.